Hey, everybody. Welcome to Citizen by CNN. I'm Dana Bash, and you see this incredible panel of power journalists who are also incredible women and friends, and everything that you can imagine that they are. Watching them, they are even better. So you and I, all of us, are in for a real treat to be able to speak to these fantastic journalists. And by the way, it is the end, but it still is Women's History Month, so it's another way to honor women. And these women in particular, over the last 35, 40 days now, have showed incredible compassion and courage and done remarkable storytelling about the horrors that are happening in Ukraine and in its bordering countries, watching the refugees. Sara was in Poland at refugee camps. Erin Burnett, you see there, was our first anchor from the domestic side in Ukraine before the war started, and was there as the war began. And of course, you see Brianna Keilar there, who has been on the air for four hours a morning since the war began, telling the stories of people over there. And I should say, Brie is going to head over to Ukraine at the end of the week. And so we want to talk about all of this. And Erin, I want to start with you, because on your show, there's so many crises and that have been going on between COVID and inflation and, you know, so many things that have taken our attention. But you were really focused on what Vladimir Putin was doing as he was building up his military around Ukraine. And I know you really wanted to go there, even before the war started. Can you just talk a bit about your experience being there when there was still peace, and then as the war began?
Yeah, I mean, I think, you know, that is sort of what encapsulates it the most, Dana, for me, was just that actual transition. Because other places, you know, war zones that I've covered as a journalist, whether it's Afghanistan or Iraq, I have always gone to when, you know, there's a war going on, right? You don't see it before. You see the devastation. That's the experience that you have. And in this case, it was the actual transition from what appeared to be normalcy. We went to a school, kids are playing basketball and volleyball after school. And in fact, they had just come back that week from the Omicron COVID situation. And then they wake up the next day, they hear missiles landing, and their lives have completely changed in every way. And that's what happened. It was this, I mean, it was ominous. There was this weight, there was this fear and this uncertainty for sure. And that was very real and very tangible. But there was also normalcy. There was people going to work, people living their lives, people going to restaurants, right? And that was such a part of it. There was no canary in the coal mine that they thought this was happening and no one else did. They did not think this was happening. And then all of a sudden it happened. And I think that seeing that transition was one of the most impactful experiences I've had as a journalist in any sort of a tense situation or a war zone, because I've never seen the transition from a pre-war to war like that before.
Yeah. And I should say, I neglected to say that we are delighted to take your questions, those of you who are watching, and you can still submit questions as we are having our discussion in the box to the on the right of your screen. Sara, I'm going to go to you next about your experience. You have this tremendous new show on CNN Plus. I know you were in the prep stages for that, but as soon as this war broke out, you saw what was happening, particularly with the human crisis, the humanitarian crisis, and you wanted to be there.
Yeah, I think, you know, it's interesting, Erin, talking about the before and after, because I got there right as the after was just beginning. And at first you saw just a trickle of people, really. It was mostly cars. There were a few people on foot. And 3 to 5 days later, it was a flood of mostly, almost exclusively, mothers and children, every now and then an animal, a dog, a cat, coming over that border on foot. And I think what really struck me was that they were carrying so little. So one bag, often a small bag, and I was wondering, how they even got there. And some people took trains, and some people took trains, then cars, then walked. But what happened to a lot of people at the beginning is that there was such a backup of thousands of people at the border that they had to leave their stuff behind. Like they brought a bigger suitcase, but they ended up sometimes leaving that because they just simply couldn't carry that and the kids and the stuff for the children to be able to make it through what were intensely frigid conditions. And it was really hard to see that number of mothers and children just standing there freezing in 0 to below 0 temperatures with no real plan. You know, the uncertainty is crushing. In everyday life, we hate uncertainty. These families are trying to navigate a brand new world in a language they may or may not know, and not knowing when or if they will ever be able to go home. It was really hard to see that, to watch and listen to that.
Yeah, I can't even imagine. And both of you, your coverage was extraordinary. And Brianna, yours has been too, because you have been doing those interviews with people who have come across the border, the human interviews, obviously with politicians and elected officials, both there in the region and around the world. You are also a military spouse. You are a mom of two small children. And so talk about it from that perspective, because I know you have some unique, unique perspective.
I think, gosh, the kids, I think to your point, Sarah and Erin, having watched your reporting too, as you were making that struggle to get across the border and you could see what families were going through, I just picture my kids as those kids. I think that's what a lot of people have done as they've looked at this, and you've seen the indiscriminate and maybe less than indiscriminate shelling that's gone on, and you've seen, you know, some of these demonstrations of how many children have died. And I don't, that just hits me so much. I was personally just struggling as a viewer, you know, watching our show for so many hours a day, coming home at the end of the day and sort of absorbing, I think, what I'd seen just as a human being, you know, incredibly, incredibly difficult, and watching it all unfold in real time. You know, I think, and especially through your reporting, we've gotten such a sense of what some of the minutes and the hours have felt like. I hope our viewers have taken some of that away as well. You know, I have been struck by a couple of things as a military spouse. One, everyone's kind of, everyone's a military spouse in Ukraine right now with, so many people between the ages of, what is it, 18 and 60, have to stay and fight. But I also think about it as a military family from the other side, which is the Russian side. This is something that I've been thinking a lot about, which is our reference point as Americans is that not that many people serve, and that's because we have an all volunteer force. And so when you sign up to serve, there's a understanding that you have as a family. You hope nothing ever happens, but you have thought about what could happen. You've thought about the fact that there's a possibility that your loved one could die. One of the things that I've really thought about is from the Russian side of things, if you are a mother or a significant other of these Russian very young men who have not signed up to serve, they've been conscripted. So these are draftees. And you just think of the sheer numbers of how many of them have died. And you think that your son was heading off for like a walk in the park because that's what you were told, or maybe you weren't told much. And the next thing you know, he is one, dead, and two, you don't even have a body to bury, because that's what we're seeing so often in these cases. I wonder how much can the public opinion in Russia withstand that? You know, the death of a son, a significant other in Russia is the same as it is in America. And just the numbers, the sheer numbers that we're talking about, you cannot hide that from the Russian people. And I really wonder how they're going to absorb the numbers of dead that, honestly, we cannot fathom in America. We think we can because of recent conflicts. This, like, it bowls it over. So I am very curious to see how that plays out over time.
Yeah, no question. And what you said, and I'm glad you mentioned that, because you said this to me in a text, Brie, about the Russian families, that, you know, this is first and foremost Vladimir Putin's war, and it is important to remember that we don't know exactly the numbers, but it appears that many of those fighting are doing so because they're told to do so, and certainly their families are not necessarily backing of the war. We just don't know. I want to get to a question from Raquel in South Carolina. The weight of the current war between Ukraine and Russia adds to the weight of financial burdens inherited from our current pandemic. This is worrisome for many, especially women who have families to feed on a small or limited budget. Never have we faced a pandemic, war, and possibility of a global war all at once. How do we even begin to process the need to prepare for all possibilities? So this question appears to be talking about American families and American women. But I, as you answer that, Erin, I'll go back to you. Talk about it from the perspective of the weight on, of the families who you met in Ukraine, who you talked about the fact that the children were learning at home still because of the pandemic and they had just gone back. So you kind of have to remember that these families had all faced the trauma that families here in America had faced with everything that went along with the pandemic. And now they have the ultimate, which is a war-torn country.
Yeah, I mean, and it's amazing when you think about it. Actually, Ivan Watson done a fantastic report on some of these kids now are trying to learn remotely. You've got teachers in Kyiv still trying to teach classrooms. And obviously that remote learning, you know, frustration and difficulty is something everyone can relate to. And then when you layer in this, you go, my gosh, but these children need to learn. They need to learn to read. And in Poland, they're putting them in schools. They don't speak Polish. So these families, just the complete and utter disruption. And financially, you know, in many cases, right, the people who left at the very beginning may have had places to go, but many of the subsequent families did not. So, you know, I know all these people in Poland who have just taken in families. They have no idea how long they're going to be there, and they have no idea how they're going to feed them. So the financial pressures everywhere are so severe. And in the United States, I mean, we all know it's real. I mean, some of the inflation numbers that we're seeing are stunning. I mean, you can say, okay, it's a 40-year high. You can say that only so many times. I mean, what people are experiencing is incredibly difficult. And I think, Dana, that the big picture on that is going to be obviously the political story in the U.S. I know as you cover so much, but I also think it puts a lot of pressure on what happens in the war situation. You can already see now it's not just China and India; it's all going to be all kinds of places that are buying Russian energy without saying they're doing it, getting it at a discount. But anything they can do to try to alleviate and ameliorate some of the pain that people are feeling at home. So you have a very brief window where the sanctions are going to be at their peak, and then you're going to start to see that really possibly start to fall apart because of this incredible financial pressure that you're seeing around the world. It really does put a timeline on things. You know, you don't have an infinite time and patience because there is a pain being exacted across Europe and in the United States as well.
I want to pick up on one thing that you said, Erin, and put it to Sara. Sara, since you were in Poland, the notion of, you know, so many times around the world when we see a refugee crisis, you see people sleeping in tents or in makeshift areas, and you don't see a lot of that, especially given the fact that you're talking about upwards of 3 million people at least going through Poland. And it is, Erin, as you said, because so many everyday families are welcoming Ukrainians into their homes and actually housing them. Talk about that, because you were there and you saw it.
So there are two things going on here, and I would be loath not to mention that, you know, I had some of the same feelings when I saw Syrians coming across the border and then seeing the conditions in which they were stuck in, as opposed to the conditions which the Ukrainian mothers and children were stuck in, and they are starkly different. And part of this is not just the families who have opened their homes, but it is the government policy on who they let in to their country with ease. The Ukrainians have been able, because partly this is, I hate to bring it up, but there is a racial undertone here. There is even a religious undertone here. And what is heartening is when someone is struggling, when a mother and child need a place to stay, and a government says, you can come in, we are opening our doors, which Poland, to their credit, has done in spades. And then the families respond because the government says, yes, you can come in. And the families respond with, you can come in to our personal space, our home, and we'll give you a place to live. It is such a beautiful response to a crisis. The issue, though, is for how long? I can't tell you how many people I talked to who had somewhere to go, but their question was, how long is, can this be indefinite? Can't, like, how long am I going to be there? And no one, not a single person that I spoke with, wanted to say it was going to be long. Every single person, a 13-year-old boy I talked to said, I'm, you know, I don't think this is going to last more than a few weeks. A mother said a couple of weeks more. Like, no one wanted to internalize and admit to themselves that even if they do get to go back, in some places, there is nothing to go back to. So I'm of two minds. It's watching this happen, having seen it happen in places like Afghanistan and in Syria, it's hard to rectify the difference, but also such a beautiful kindness to see the response by people, everyday people, and not just Poland. By the way, we saw a lot of people from Germany. Buses, they brought in buses from Berlin saying, if you want to go to Berlin, and there was a little sign on there, it was like, if you want to go to Berlin, we're trying to help you find a place to stay. And these were just regular people. This wasn't a government, you know, thing. And so I have to say, I was heartened by it and hope that, you know, wars, we can't seem to stop doing it as human beings. I'm hoping that this is a lesson for us in the future.
Bree, do you want to add to that?
Oh, yeah. I was just going to say, I also think there's, and I definitely, of course, I think that there are racial undertones in what we're seeing in terms of like the appetite for who is accepted. And I also think there's another thing, which is that a couple of things. From the American point of view, I think that the historic reference point for fighting what is considered a noble war and one that most Americans are connected to is a war in Europe. Think of World War II, you think of the connections of families, whether it's fighting in that war or it, Dana, in your case, in your family's case, surviving that war. And I think it's something that it doesn't require a lot of imagination of Americans to think about what is possibly at stake. In Poland, it certainly does not require a lot of imagination. That is where World War II started. And part of what started in Poland was that you saw there were certain countries that actually had security, I guess, guarantees with Poland, and they did the bare minimum, you know, or you could argue they didn't do enough really to stop things from spreading beyond Poland. And so that's a reference point too for Britain and for France and for all of the countries around there. I think that they understand that a little more, but I also just think, you know, for Americans, like I mentioned the all-volunteer force before in the military, so there's very, very few Americans who are actually connected to the idea of military action or who that might demand something of. That wasn't the case, you know, in the 40s at all. You had so many people who were fighting. It's a part of so many American family stories. And so I think it's something that they consider potentially worthwhile supporting. I do think it's interesting, as you brought up, Sara, for how long? How long is that going to last? Because the reference point still for Americans are your personal one, which is inflation. You're already, you know, getting bit by the fact that things are costing more. If you're living paycheck to paycheck, at a certain point, it just becomes unsustainable. So while you may be wanting to even support something, or you may be there with the idea of what you think is protecting democracy, how far does that go when you're struggling to put food on the table? That's also a very good question.
It is a good question. Here's another one from Colleen in Florida. Besides donations, what else can the U.S. do for the refugees, specifically women and families? That's a jump ball. Anybody can take that.
They just I mean, the announcement that they are going to allow 100,000 refugees to come into the United States was one of the things. It's offering refuge, most literally, to people. I do wonder how many of those people, because then you have to talk about the details of what that means, and that is a whole nother kettle of fish. But there is that, but I also think it's helping the countries that surround, because a lot of people don't want to go this far from their homes. They want the connection there. They have family. So I do think that maybe one of the other answers is to try and help shore up the other countries who are taking the brunt of this, the brunt of the number of people coming over. But that requires money. And as Brianna very rightly said, like, inflation, all of these issues are hitting people in the pocketbook, in their lives. And so it's going to be tricky.
Erin, do you want to add something?
Well, I agree completely with that. And I think it is helping the countries there, because when you look at Hungary, for example, and Hungary was the country that we came out through, you know, Sara, to the points that you raised, right? They had literally built a wall because they did not want Syrian immigrants coming into Hungary. They have opened their arms to Ukrainian immigrants and refugees. And so, yes, there are clearly racial undertones to that. But it has been transformative for Hungary in the sense of, you saw the same emotion and heartbreak on women's faces there, Hungarian women, when they would talk about seeing a family, right? And what it meant to them, you know, how they feel as a woman seeing that woman and children coming through. Mm-hmm. But so in a sense, Hungary has opened its heart a bit. But in other countries, you know, Sara's saying in Poland, the question of how long is so crucial, because which way is this going to go? Right, there is only so much that a society will be able to withstand. You know, when you're talking about people with their own children saying, okay, I want to do everything I can, but here my kids are now in classrooms where I have another 10 kids who are from Ukraine who don't speak Polish. And so now my kids' education, right, so how long are they going to be willing to take that? So I agree with you, Sara, that I think anything we can do to support those countries so that you don't end up seeing a sort of eventual backlash of, wait a minute, too much. Maybe not literal walls going up, but right, Hungary is an example of how things can go when you are not welcoming, with that Syrian example, and you've got to provide the support. Because 100,000 refugees coming to the United States, given our population versus what's happening to Poland, is obviously, it's one drop in a very large bucket, right? That's really nothing compared to what those countries are taking on every day.
It's also just remarkable to see, this morning I was with a Ukrainian member of parliament. She and four or five of her colleagues are here, and they have been for a couple of days, and they've been having meetings in Washington. She was walking the halls in Congress, talking to her legislative brethren here in the United States, and just begging for aid, and we hear Zelensky, President Zelensky, saying it over and over and over again in his daily address and his speeches to parliaments all around the globe, including one to Congress a couple of weeks ago, just begging for help, saying each of you has referenced the very real history in Europe, the very real history that the United States was part of in Europe, where, you know, everybody said never again. That was very specific to the Holocaust, but the argument that this member of parliament made to me was, regardless of who is getting killed, this is never again happening again. Never again is now doesn't matter because it is happening. And she's a two-year-old at home, and she has on her phone, she has an app with an air siren capability to tell her when the air sirens are going off while she's sitting here in Washington with members of Congress. And so it's that kind of thing that Erin and Sara, you saw in person real time, and Brianna, you're going to see when you go over there in a couple of days. And on that note, this is a question from Tiffany from California. How can we empower more women, both young and old? I think that's an open-ended question. You can take that a million directions, but, you know, we can keep it on the topic of Ukraine and all of the ramifications. Anyone?
I'll jump in.
Sarah?
I'll jump in.
Sarah.
How incredibly strong. You know, people talk about, you know, women and, you know, over the years, there have been lots of things said about women. It was like, can we work? Can we do this? Can we juggle? Can we look at the women that are coming over that border? And some, by the way, our colleague Ed Lavandera did this incredible piece of a woman who had made it to Poland and decided she was going to go back and she was going to go fight alongside her fellow citizens, that she couldn't be in comfort and stay away, that she had to go back. And women are making these decisions, and it's not just one. And I think it is, it tells you so much about the strength of women who are able to, at the very last minute, in sheer terror that would scare any human being on this earth, think straight, get their families, get them to safety, make sure they have at least the bare minimum of what they need, get it together within sometimes an hour or so, and make all the plans as they're doing this, trying to get across a border, and then to have some plan to have a place to be. I mean, that's incredible strength. And if you look at that and you say, well, if they can do that, if these women can do that in this dire of a time, the possibilities are endless for what we can do in a different scenario and different setting. So I'll leave it there.
Yeah, I will jump off on that and say, I think to your point, Sarah, it's looking at, this is not the choice of so many of these families. This is not the choice of these women. And you can be empowered by their example. Right? What is the saying about the hot water in the tea bag, Dana? You never know how strong a woman is. She's like a tea bag, right? You never know how strong she is until she's in hot water. I think I butchered that. That was terrible. But in fairness, I get up at 3 a.m. So
that was really good, Brianna. What are you talking about? I'm using
it. You nailed it.
No, but I will say, I feel, I, when you asked that question, I almost felt a little bit powerless in a way, because I too am in awe of what we're seeing. And the other thing I will say that I've noticed, whether it's empowering women or really empowering anyone, something I've learned throughout the coverage of my colleagues is that you can be empowered by whatever it is that you do, whatever your talent is or your interest is. We've done a lot of stories on artists who are using incredible images to tell a story. We've all seen, you know, today it was sort of an artist colony in Lviv, and my colleague John Berman had done a story on an artist who had this incredible image of what looked like a building that was bombed out, but he'd also put the images of the people living their lives in the apartments in this building. And I thought, we've all seen the video of these bombed out buildings. But this artist reminded us what is destroyed. You know, he just sort of made that cognitive leap. And I've been amazed, whether it's, whatever it is, whether it's teachers, whether it's even just doctors, and whether they're Ukrainian or maybe they're American. We've seen incredible work through St. Jude's in America. They've got a partnership. Just taking whatever it is they do and they're contributing. And I think it's just a reminder for everyone when they're looking at situations like this, that, you know, whether it's amazing women who are taking up arms, oh my goodness, that doesn't have to be the only way that people can contribute. There's so much you can do in your home country. There's so much you can do to help people out. I've really just been in awe of how people are using their various talents.
I think that's a great point. I also was just, as you were saying that, I was thinking about the woman who died on the bridge in Irpin, that her husband found out that it was her and their children, because he recognized the backpacks of his children on Twitter. And in such an indescribable moment, I mean, to just think of such a thing. I just thought about her, like she got her children together. She was taking them out. She was doing all of the things that you all are speaking of. And she was also one of the top people at an IT company that's actually, happens to be an American IT company. And one of the things that I saw in Ukraine, you know, you have this country that's very much betwixt and between, right? There's an average income And then there's the below that, and then the above that. And the above that is this massively sophisticated, growing IT sector. They have companies there that are incredibly global, that are, you know, if you, a high-end fancy cars, Porsche, BMW, whatever, those sat-nav systems, those are designed in Ukraine. There's this whole economy that is pushing towards the future and something bigger, and there are an unbelievable number of women in it. And I think, as you know, I think we all hope and pray that the situation moves forward, but you have a destructed country in so many ways, all those cities that we've all seen, but also these entire industries and the support that Ukraine is going to need for people to be able to go back, and for those women to go back to reconstruct their families and their cities and whatever opportunities they want career-wise. They're just going to need to be so much support so that people can actually realize that, as opposed to if this does end anytime soon, and who knows what will happen, that it isn't okay, great, it's over. They can go back, right? Like, that's what we keep talking about. But it's also in terms of the women's ability to build and grow in whatever they want, there's gonna need to be a lot of support there too, so that they can go back and build those careers.
Erin,
as you're talking, go ahead, Sara.
One last thought, because I thought of it as Erin and Brianna were talking about these issues. One of the things I think that can empower women, and I'm just say a woman, is our self-talk. I feel like that is such a difficult thing, and it's so very personal. Mine's not great, I'm working on it, but I think that is one of the things, because when you tell yourself—
Wait, what do you mean by that?
I mean, when you are thinking about yourself, oftentimes, mm-hmm. I will speak personally, because I don't know everyone's experience, but oftentimes it's, you're too fat, you've got to lose weight, you didn't do that right. It is all the critique, all the criticism, and none of the praise, right? You didn't do this, you didn't make this, why don't you have more saved? Why don't you, you know, all of these things, right? And it is so easy to self-criticize all the time. You can't grow that way. That goes nowhere. If you could think forward as like, I'm going to do this, I am going to, as opposed to why didn't I? I think the self-talk stops us, and that's something that we have sometimes societally and sometimes just a personal battle. But I think sort of our self-talk has a lot to do with how we're able to push ourselves forward.
Yeah.
I think you might be in the wrong line of work. I think therapy should be your line of work, because I'm like writing all this stuff. I want these catchphrases. Tell me.
You've seen Sara in the field. She basically does therapy. She's a service operator. No, it's true. And unfortunately, sometimes that, what do you call it? Self-talk?
Yeah.
Okay. Sometimes that self-talk is a luxury to be able to take the time to think about that. And the images and the reality and the, you know, face-to-face observations that you, Erin and Sara made, and Brianna, you're about to make, is a reminder that when the you know what hits the fan and you got to do something, especially as a woman, you just do it. You just do it. You just get shit done. And that's who we are. That's what we do. That's what we've done for millennia, since the beginning of humankind. And that's the truth. And, Erin, you have three young children, and I was, of course, thinking about you when you were over there, just like I was thinking about Clarissa and, you know, Jim Sciutto, not just women, but men as well, about what you tell your children. And what did you tell your children, either when you were there, I don't know if you were FaceTiming with them or just talking to them traditionally on the phone, and then when you came back?
I tried to FaceTime with them, you know, as often as I could. You know, they consume a lot of news because of what I do. So they probably saw more than other children their age, and probably more than they should have. So they did have a lot of questions. They're 8, 6, and 3, and obviously 3 doesn't really, you know, he's he doesn't have a lot of questions, but the other two have a lot, and they really, it's difficult, because one of the things I've really tried to focus in on with them is them understanding the difference between a government and its people, and what people are like. So when they talk about Vladimir Putin, and giving them the opportunity to understand what Brianna started with, the Russian soldiers, and you know why are they there, and that they have families too, and how do people feel? That people are different than governments. So that's one thing that I really tried to explain with them. But you know, they ask why Vladimir Putin did this, and you know these are hard questions to answer. I mean, no one really knows the answer to that question. So I think, in as they always say, right, sometimes the questions of children illuminate so much, because you know they will ask a simple question that other people, adults, just assume that they won't bother asking, or they won't touch, but kids will. So they asked a lot of questions, and they had worries and concerns, you know, they're children, so they're very resilient, just like Sarah, I know you saw with the children there. I mean, I think one of the most disturbing things for me seeing children there was how much they would keep it in, you know, like a mother would be weeping, speaking to you, just weeping, and her children would be dripping off of her like mine would, or Brianna, your kids are young too, yours would, as if, and there'd be no different look on their face than yours would have in a situation in your house. And you know, inside they're in turmoil, their lives are changing, they don't know what to make of it, but on the outside it doesn't always show that way, and that they seem to be so normal and so stoic. And you can imagine how distressing it is for a child to see their mother weeping, completely weeping like that, and you know, walking miles and miles over a border. The children are bearing so much of the brunt of this, and we have no idea what that even means right now.
Mm-hmm. I was struck by the silence. The silence of the children. I was really struck by how quiet it was with hundreds of kids. And I didn't hear anybody crying. And I just noticed it, I think on the air, I stopped and said, I just want you to listen to something for just a few seconds. And it was dead air, which nobody ever likes. But I'm like, do you hear that? There's no kids crying, but you see them all, right? You see everybody. And that is a bad sign. It is a bad sign. They are traumatized and they're in shock and they're trying to process all of this. And so their normal childlike behavior has ended for a while. It killed me.
Yeah.
Bree, what do you say to your kids? I mean, your kids have a different perspective because they have a dad who gets deployed.
Yeah, they're young enough, though, that I don't think they fully have understood what that has meant with my husband, Fernando, deploying. We have a 3 and a 5-year-old. So like the 3-year-old, he just knows if you're there or not, really. Like, you're not going to explain the concept of war. The 5-year-old, the last time my husband deployed, which wasn't all that long ago, but it ended at the beginning of the pandemic. So it was long enough ago that he didn't fully understand it. Through COVID, we have had to talk to Teddy about death, you know, so that he can understand that there's just no way around that. And he doesn't fully grasp that. But as this invasion was starting and the war was starting, my husband was explaining, it was actually really Fernando who was explaining it to him, you know, what war is. That yes, people die in war, that even sometimes includes children. And he had a really, I don't know, he has a really kind of good rudimentary way, I think, of explaining it. And when I was talking to Fernando about going to Ukraine to cover it, and I no way would I put myself in a category with Clarissa Ward, you know, just to be clear about where I'm going to be covering it. But he was like, well, what are you going to tell the kids? And I haven't had a lot of experience, obviously, in war zones. And I said, I don't know. Well, what do I tell the kids? And he said, well, you have to tell them you're going, and you have to tell them where you're going. So I was trying to explain it. And when I told Teddy, he said, oh, so are you going to die? And he said it just very matter of factly. I'm like, no, Teddy, I'm not going to die, because he just has very limited understanding of it. To be honest, it's a little creepy. He didn't even seem that concerned about it. He's just trying to fit back into the place. I don't think he's not fully there where he's kind of understanding it. To Antonio, who's our three-year-old, I've just had to repeat, say every day, I'm going to go away for a little while. It's going to be for a little longer than I've traveled before. I'm going to be in touch with you. And I'm just kind of getting him used to that idea. But they're so little, they don't fully grasp it. I think it does sort of illuminate these little kids that you're seeing. What are they picking up? I wonder, you know, Sara, as you cover this and you say they're quiet and they're clearly not fully understanding it, but it's starting to sink in, you know, that their understanding is so limited.
Yeah, it depends also. And you know this, you are all mothers, depends on the age. The older they are, the more they understand the concepts of things. And I wonder if they suffer more, or the kids that don't understand but know something is terribly wrong and don't know how to fix it. I am no psychologist, even though apparently I sounded like one for a minute there, according to Dana. But I do think that when you talk to the very young ones, you know, like there's a way to say, like, what did you see? Like, what did you see? And the older ones, to me, they sound so adult sometimes that it scares me, right? The way that they answer things so matter-of-factly, like it scares me, because I feel like, God, it shouldn't be matter-of-fact that someone saw a bomb go off and that they were panicking and scared for their lives. And so it will definitely, I'm sure it will haunt them. I mean, also, they will start to realize things are really abnormal. This isn't just a trip, as the weeks go on, where they can't go back home, where they can't have their normal life and where things are difficult. So I think there's going to be there is so much healing that's going to have to happen. And I just don't know when will that begin? I don't know.
We're almost out of time. Erin, I want to end with you and give us one hopeful note on something that you saw or experienced while you were in Ukraine.
It ties right into the kind of the overall theme here, and we're talking about women and children. It was, and the strength of them, but also just so all these women and children are going, and that was, you know, this kind of mass exodus and fear, right? And they would get on a train or a bus or whatever it was, you know, meeting people coming from all different places. And then they would meet each other. And they would start to talk, and they would become a little group. And then, so about this one group, and they were getting on the bus together. And I'm like, oh, so you know each other, because they were together, right? Five children, three mothers. No, we just met on the train. And then I was working with a woman there that I had met and kind of gotten to know her. And she went to Germany. She sends me these pictures from the train. There's 10 children piled up on top of each other. And she has one child. She's like, oh, the one in the blue coat, you know, that's my child. And I said, oh, who are those, your friends? And she's like, no, I met them on the train. And just this, you know, this moment that human beings can meet each other out of nowhere and form these incredible bonds of trust, because this is complete
especially
trust,
women.
Right? Women would turn, they would take turns, right? Because you're spending 36 hours, 72 hours in some cases, right? They would talk about, well, people would just give up their seat so that someone could take a nap, and then they would switch again. Right. And then you would have these people that you just met, and you would have to fall asleep and pass out, and your child's there, and you've never met anyone, and you trust them to take care of your children. And it's that in the midst of everything that a civilized society would have being ripped apart for absolutely no reason, you have these incredible bonds of trust that were formed in the most difficult of situations. And that to me was a bright light about it, was this that incredible glimpse of humanity.
That's such an incredible observation, because you can see, again, going back to the days in the cave, that's what women did, right? You get together, you form a community, and you take care of everything that you need to take care of. And that is still happening. It's part of our sensibility, I think, as women. And boy, are you three women incredible. I'm so proud to call each of you a colleague and a friend, and thank you so much. I know for a fact that everybody who is listening to you learned a lot and felt a lot. which is so important right now. And I also have to say congratulations to Sara Sidner, who started a new CNN Plus show. It's called The Big Picture. It's awesome. Anybody who's watching this who has not yet subscribed to CNN Plus, please do it, if for nothing else than to see Sara's great show. I'm also going to be part of, and Erin, I know you are, and I think you are too, Bri, the interview club, where you can go on to CNN Plus and you can participate in discussions like the one we just had, not just with CNN reporters, but we're going to have guests of all different shapes and sizes and from all walks of life and all from politics to pop culture, you name it. So thank you so much. Have a great afternoon. Talk to you guys soon. Bye, everyone.
Love you, Dana.
Bye. Proud to work with you, ladies. Bye.
Bye, guys.